Welcome into the final Hoops postgame show of the season for the men's team as they come up short in a much anticipated matchup with the Aggies of Texas A&M, 98-83. This was had all the makings of a great one within the first 5 minutes when Nebraska and Texas A&M were trading buckets back and forth. But by the end of the first half, Nebraska had dug themselves in quite a hole, 58-44. Those 58 points given up to Texas A&M were the most in the first half in the NCAA tournament action for anybody, not Nebraska, obviously, for anybody since 2008. Also, more points given up in that first half than seven games total for Nebraska. So that was part of the problem. Texas A&M, obviously, just going off. They had a few guys that just played very well, very difficult, and Nebraska's defensive game plan obviously didn't live up to the billing tonight. But I'm Jake Bakovin alongside DP. Thanks to Action Plumbing, Heating, AC, and Electrical for sponsoring our show all year long, as well as Wall to Wall Wine and Spirits. We thank you guys immensely. We also will have Eric Strickland and Jake Sorensen, once they're done with their post-game duties in Memphis, set to join us here as well. We'd like to thank the 1890 Initiative for help sponsoring that. So we've got a lot to break down here, DP. I'll give the floor to you for your initial thoughts on a season-ending loss for Nebraska. Very successful season, obviously, but Husker fans showed up great in Memphis. A big group of Nebraska fans there, but they're going to have to maybe not extend those hotels until Sunday.
Well, first thing to the season, congratulations and thank you. Congratulations and thank you. If we said before season started that this team would go into, it would have the season that it had, it would knock off two top five teams in a matter of a month, that it would get into the double bye, it would be a higher seeded team in a matchup in the first round of the tournament, we would applaud. We would have applauded. We would have thrown confetti. We would have popped champagne. So to Coach Hoiberg and this Husker team and to Husker Nation, this has been a pretty cool run. It's a pretty cool run, especially from where you were to get to where you are, and rightfully so, being disappointed. But before you get into the nuts and bolts and go into a rager, I'm going to say thank you, because it's been a pretty – I would take this six-month run over any of the five that I've been here.
Oh, yeah.
By a lot. And it gives me some hope about forward, that you figured out some things. Does it mean that you have it all mastered? No. Does it mean that it's perfect? No. But did you take some serious steps forward? Yeah, you did. Yeah, you did. To the players on the team, job well done. Look, KSA became a thing and put Nebraska's name in people's mouths in a very positive way, maybe as much as in any other player in quite a while. And Coach Hoiberg winning Coach of the Year. Like, those are all things that need to be said. So before we get into the raging, ranting, et cetera, and we'll read your text centered, of course, and quite frankly, your opinion, if you're just going to pick at people, we probably won't read it. But if you have something to say about this basketball season, tonight is its own episode. But the season, the season was a good season. So I'll say thank you before we get into the real nuts and bolts of it.
Yeah, and I like that. I mean, because it's important to remember, because Nebraska basketball just in these past 5 years, it's been building up to this moment, you could say, but really to this season. And it has been one that is a long-suffering Nebraska basketball fan, and I can somewhat say that because they don't get into these moments very often. I'll sign up for an 8 seed for the next 20 years, 50 years. I don't care. Any opportunity to get a season like this for Nebraska basketball is incredible. That being said, I mean, there's plenty of reasons to believe that they could take another step forward next year. So, I mean, in no way is a disappointing performance in the NCAA tournament being just one game once again, going to bring down any momentum that this program has. Obviously, if you are able to make a run in the NCAA tournament, you can garner a lot more of that and really kind of change the speak around your program, the talk around your program. But I think they've done that already. So, I mean, I think to a degree, and not all programs are in this position, right? Kentucky's going to be going through the feelings quite a bit, you know, so there's different kind of ways to look at this thing. But I've kind of said it already that Nebraska's somewhat playing with house money because they already have a successful season under their wing, by getting the double bye in the Big Ten. And then of course winning a game there. And then just making this appearance again, it's the second time since 1998, the second day since 1998 that Nebraska fans have been able to look for an NCAA tournament game. And for that, we'd like to thank the Huskers. And like you said, I mean, there's going to be some guys that are missed. Tominaga saw a lot of his jerseys going around. I mean, he will forever be a fan favorite. And how about Josiah Alec? I know he missed a few bunnies today, but talk about battling on the boards and knowing the assignment, as they say, against a Texas A&M team that is one of the best offensive rebounding teams, not just this year, but over the last 6-7 years. Mm-hmm. And Alec was really battling on the boards there, finished with 11. I think he had like 7. I have to go back to halftime, 7 or 8 at halftime. Mm-hmm. And so both those guys, obviously seniors, but a majority of your roster coming back. And a lot to build off of in this game. As we kind of just step back and look at this, I mean, because there's different ways you can look at it. It's a one game sample size. So, you know, I don't think that this is necessarily how it would play every time you step on the floor with the Texas A&M Aggies. But is there part of this? I mean, the athleticism that A&M had seemed to put pressure on Nebraska. Is that fair to say?
Well, I mean, here's the thing. Husker fans know who their team is. There's not anybody who watched this team this year that doesn't know who they are. You know that this team, when it does certain things well, it does everything else better. And if you're battling on the boards against somebody that is elite in what they do, they're elite in it.
We saw it today.
They're elite in it. And you know that it was drilled. You know that it was talked about ad nauseum, you know, to the team. You know that they went through drills and workouts. But here's the thing. Bach, you can know that you've got a rebound against Eric Strickland if y'all are one-on-one in the gym. All the one in the world is not going to get you plus rebounds against Eric Strickland. He has an advantage over you, and there's a reason why he has the advantage over you. So we're not surprised. We know that this is not the most athletic team in the tournament. We also know that, here's the thing, go with me here, that of the 68 teams, only one ends the season feeling like they accomplish and they're a good team. Everybody else, do you think that Kentucky wants to burn down its basketball program?
A few fans.
No, yeah, but we're not, listen. I've never been one to listen to the, like, I, why? Just get better. You're closer to a national championship than 98% of the programs in the country. Nebraska went from being a considered 12-13 seed in its conference to a 3 seed. And it did it through a whole lot of hard work, a whole lot of great nights, a whole lot of great coaching, a whole lot of development. You just got beat by a team that was better than you tonight. Look, and here's the thing. When Nebraska got 3 scorers scoring like they did, they beat all but 18 of the teams who were in the tournament. Unfortunately, you got lined up against a gang. Listen, I said in old school today, and Jay and I were talking, and I said, I do want to correct a thing that's been said far too much about this Texas A&MU team. They shot in their last 12 SEC games, they shot 42% from 3. They were plus 10 rebounds per game. In the SEC, they were, get this, that they had seven fewer turnovers per game than their opponents. You can go through and listen, from now on, just a little note, I don't care who says it, go do your own work. Because if you watch Texas A&M against Kentucky, they looked like the better team to Kentucky. And a week ago, that would have mattered. Last night, because we saw Kentucky tank it against Oakland, like, we started to think less of the whole thing. But no, they lost to Texas A&M because, drumroll, Texas A&M is talented.
Yeah.
How they've lost as many games as they lost is a mystery, because the things that they do travel. Now, are you going to tell me that Rink Mass isn't a good big? Well, he had a bad night to have a bad night. He picked a bad night to have a bad night. This is what it was. So here's what I'm thinking, Bach, and we can go in another direction if you want, because I'm cool with it. But I think having the text line tell us what they think happened tonight, and then tell us what they think about the season. And you either or, right? And you don't have to be right. Be considerate, right? Because nobody's going to fix Nebraska basketball enough tonight to have beaten Texas A&M. That's over. What you're trying to figure out is, what's the next thing? Okay, so what did we learn? We learned that we had a wonderful young man from Japan. We got a really good transfer in Rink Mass. We got another really good transfer in Bryce Williams. We got a really good like, there are some dudes on this roster. And there are some questions. But you can't write off an entire season as a fail, because that's simply not true. How you feel about it is one thing. But to say that it was a fail, no, not true.
Yeah, far from it. Nebraska had a spectacular season. And as you mentioned, some of those transfers, I mean, you know, you have to step back and look at the new face of college football, the new way of college football wave, I should say, is all five starters were transfers to Nebraska at some point. So, you know, we'll see what kind of happens in the offseason. Again, there's plenty of time to kind of dictate that. But yeah, as to Texas A&M too, you know, they're a team like every team. You play 30 some games, you're going to kind of go through your ups and downs. They had a 5-game losing streak. Maybe you played them, you know, at that time, maybe Nebraska would have got them. But I mean, I think one thing that was really obvious today is they've got some weapons, and more than Taylor and Radford, which I think was kind of, if you just kind of look at, I guess, their season averages, those are the ones that kind of stick out. But often was mentioned throughout the broadcast and was hard not to notice was Obasaki getting 16 points in a row for Texas A&M to finish the first half. And he finished with 22. Taylor finished with 25. He could not miss from beyond the arc. And 20 points for Radford. They also had 23 off the bench combined from Carter and Coleman. So, I mean, they were playing pretty much. And when you almost get 100 points, you're hitting on all cylinders. Let me ask you about the defensive side for Nebraska, because there is a question from the janitor off the text line, and it was another hot shooting performance from beyond the arc, this time from Texas A&M, 13 of 24. He says, can you explain why teams struggle shooting the three often go off on us? Is it the defense? Is it the scheme? Luck? What is it?
Here's the real. And again, I don't expect anybody to listen to every show on the ticket, but literally today, we were just talking about the fact that one of my biggest concerns was the belief, the misguided belief, that this team couldn't shoot. Like, wait a minute. Do you think physically Kentucky matches up better against Texas A&M than Nebraska does? Right?
Yeah.
Like, they've got the length, they've got the athletes. Right. Texas A&M shot 43% from three against Kentucky. Twice. So I said, well, wait, no. The idea that Texas A&M can't shoot. Listen, stop listening to people who don't watch basketball, first of all. When it comes to basketball, Like, no, don't say that they can't shoot. Go look at there. I'm gonna help folks here. Do you know that there's not a college game that was played this year that's not available online? Mm. Like, you literally can go and watch any game, or at least the highlights, some snippets of,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Enough to get, right? There were 3 hours worth of Texas A&M game tape that I watched, and I went, if you're going into this game believing they can't shoot, you're going to help them do really well, because you're not going to close out. You're not going to defend ball. You're not going to go over top of screens. You're not. And voila. I don't care what percentage they shot during the season. The last six games that I watched, the last six games they played, they hit the three. And then they raced you to the ball. And then they put it in the basket for 2%. Listen, if you're a good offensive rebounding team, you know what happens on rebounds, offensive rebounds? You get layups. You know what's really hard to defend is somebody that's inside you to rebound, to stop them from putting that easy rebound up for a layup.
Yeah.
Like, they can't shoot. They don't care. They can rebound because they're getting an extra 0.5 shots attempt per possession over everybody else. I can miss it because I'm getting it back and getting a better shot.
They have 12 more shots than Nebraska tonight on the evening. 35-71 for Texas A&M, 27-59 for Nebraska. You know, as you break down some of these things, of course, the three-point line does kind of stand out again as far as percentages go and totals. 13 made field three-pointers from Texas A&M, the team that can't shoot, and Texas A&M, Nebraska, mm-hmm. 7 of 22. Mm-hmm. Nebraska did a really good job at the free throw line, 22 of 24. Did lose the rebounding battle, as would be expected. 14 offensive rebounds for Texas A&M, 7 for Nebraska. The assist numbers were pretty good for both teams, 16 and 15 for Texas A&M and Nebraska, respectively. And the turnovers weren't all that bad. 8 turnovers for Texas A&M and 10 for Nebraska. Again, a lot of it, you know, they just kind of got out to that margin. And Nebraska at times felt like it was trying to chase those points, but that's kind of what their offense looks like too. I mean, so sometimes you could see it like that. But this is a team that does often live and die by the threes, and Keisei Tominaga hit a few early.
He had a 5-for-11 3-point night. He had a great, come on. Like, here's the other part of this thing. You can't be embarrassed by somebody being better than you, especially in the tournament. Everybody's good in the tournament. Everybody beat a bunch of people in the tournament.
Yeah.
Right? So it always comes down to that night. Do you think that Yale is a better team if they played 10 times that they would win 9 of them? No. No.
Yeah, it's not familiar matches. It's your second time playing a Big Ten team.
Yeah, like, here's the, like, some nights the other guy's better than you. And it doesn't have to be. Listen, if they're beating you on the boards, first of all, you can't fully get into a transition offense from defensive rebounding if you're actually boxing out. It's not that Nebraska wasn't boxing out on that end. They were just still getting beat to the ball. That they jumped higher. They jumped quicker. Like, people talk rebounding effort. That's if all things are equal. We're both working hard. We both have the same arm length. We both have the same vertical.
Yeah, Nebraska's calling card, and the reason that they're here is not. I don't want to say it's not because of the rebound, because when you put in the effort, but it's not as a team like stat. That's not their strong point. So they're not necessarily winning games because they're out rebounding everybody. They've got other strengths that they work on or that they have. I will say this, though. I mean, it's hard to beat anybody when they shoot 13 of 24 from beyond the arc. I mean, we'll just start off with that. A hot three-point shooting team, that can happen. That's kind of modern-day college basketball. K Can you blame Nebraska for maybe giving, not giving up the best, or not having the best perimeter defense, or not getting there? I think that, you know, I think Nebraska will, if they go through this tape, I mean, like you just said, they go through this tape and they break it down and they got another chance at Texas A&M, they'd be looking to get some payback here. But
if they played Illinois 10 times, they would win five. Illinois would win five, and it'd be some variance upon it if they played Purdue, right? Some nights it would look like Purdue is the number one team in the country, and some nights it would look like Nebraska. You know what? They're a force. If Nebraska played Wisconsin 10 times, some of those nights, how do you think Wisconsin felt when they left Pinnacle Bank Arena this year? How did Purdue think? I feel, oh, burn it to the ground because you let that Nebraska team hit open threes against you. No, they didn't. Nebraska set it up, worked, shots went down. It's basketball. There is no, hey, I can wave the magic wand, and because it's supposed to look this way, that it works. You can run the perfect offensive set, get everybody in the right place, perfect pass, perfect timing, good look, doesn't go down. That's basketball. And at the turn, especially in March Madness, some of the things just a little off, just a little off, or just a little on. And when you're just a little on, I had this conversation years ago after Villanova Georgetown, because those two teams could play 90 times and Georgetown would win 88 of them. But on that night, they shot a record percentage that they never shot again, hadn't shot before. You could, Georgetown's terrible, terrible defense. No, that might have been one of the best defensive teams in college basketball history. They had lockdown dogs at every position too deep. But on that night, they didn't have an answer for Villanova. It happens. And the Texas said, well, another embarrassing moment. Are you embarrassed by the team that fought like they did? Bach, are you embarrassed by this?
I in no way am embarrassed by this year's team.
I just need to get that thing in. You know.
Yeah.
You know, and again, a lot of the narrative was put in play by people who don't know Nebraska basketball. They don't know basketball. The moment somebody said, well, Texas A&M doesn't shoot the ball well. Oh, boy. Here we go. Because that's what showed up in the week, right? That's what showed up. And people will say a thing enough, and people will like, well, I've heard four people say it, so it must be true. No, it wasn't true. It wasn't true. And that Texas A&M team, again, as good as they look tonight, there's no Houston or whoever they play will defend them differently than Nebraska did, because they'll have different athletes than Nebraska did. So this Texas A&M team could go to the Final Eight.
Yeah.
Or they could get stomped a mud hole in by Houston, who, I don't know, pretty fair defensive team with the same sort of athletes, different level of dog in them. Yeah, and the number one seed. So it to Nebraska, to the team, and to the foundation, again, what they did this season was so wonderful. Like, this was how we felt this afternoon was worth how we feel tonight. How we felt this over the past 4 days, and maybe the past 4 months, is that you had a basketball team that played hard, not the most talented team, but they played hard, and they beat up on some giants. They beat up on some giants.
Yeah.
A 3 seed in the Big Ten. Come on.
I mean, we just had an article in the Omaha World Herald asking, is this the best Nebraska basketball team of all time? You can't go from that to a few games later saying it's embarrassment. No way did this team embarrass. By the way, Texas A&M has played Houston this year. Again, maybe different because it's a different time of the year. Houston beat Texas A&M in Texas A&M 70-66 December 16th, if you're kind of looking at that. And if you're embarrassed by the 98 given up by Texas A&M, it is a high number, but just keep by Nebraska to Texas A&M. Keep in mind, Texas A&M, the last 4 games here, they've scored 90 against Florida, 97 against Kentucky, 80 against Mississippi and 86 against Mississippi, another one of those games. So they have been pretty much putting the ball in the bucket.
Nebraska had stretches where if they were playing in the NCAA tournament the week they played Purdue or the week they played Indiana, yeah. Remember, they balled out against Indiana. The next night, it looked a little sluggish for half the game or a third of the game. Mm-hmm. It wasn't a terrible game. For 25 of the minutes against Illinois, twice, they looked like the better team. But that's not how basketball works. Yeah. So you got to figure out a way. Like, Nebraska is not the team that lost to Minnesota early in the season. Nor are they the team that beat Minnesota later. Or a combination of both. And that's how basketball is. That's why it's called March Madness, because it's insane. You're talking about college students who still aren't fully formed. Yep. And you're trying to keep them as consistent and formed as possible under ridiculous circumstances. Right? And here's the other thing. Basketball, like, those are some of the best basketball players in the country and being judged by people who don't play basketball. Like, calm down. Celebrate your boys. Celebrate them boys. Celebrate them young men, because they made us proud all year long. And I'm not going to be the one go now. Boo! Nope. Not going to do it. What I loved was, Bach, we remember those terrible post games over the past few years where it was just hard to show up.
Yeah.
Kept showing up. This year was so much better. It was so much better. Look, I even wore a Huskers basketball hoodie, which is and today, yesterday and today at Buffalo Wings and Rings and at this station was so much fun.
Oh yeah.
It was so Lincoln. That's the Lincoln, Nebraska that I fell in love with. Those are the Husker fans that I fell in love with, because the love that was in that room today, it was chef's kiss good. It was so good to see Husker fans proud of themselves. I know the players are proud of themselves. I know the coaches are proud of themselves. And I think the fan base, you'll walk a little different this summer with your Husker gear on, because they put out the effort. You can and should be proud of this basketball team and this basketball program. If you hurt tonight, it hurts. It sucks. I'm not saying that it doesn't suck, that you should be all happy about it. No. Screw Texas A&M. Yes. And the collective horses they rode in on. Screw it. Gig yourselves. But in the disappointment is that we wanted to stay at that level of hype and good. Like, we wanted another give me Saturday with that Husker juice. Like, let me get that Kool-Aid. I'll still have it on Sunday. I have it less tonight because it hurts and some of it leaked. But Sunday, you get to go, you know what? That was pretty cool.
Well, I think that's, you know, and obviously fans are going to be frustrated at the day of the performance or whatever. And I think that's part of the hurt here and part of the excitement and part of everything, all the emotions that went into this week and into tonight is this is somewhat unfamiliar territory for Nebraska, especially, again, like I say, younger Nebraska fans who since 1998 have had 2 days, one other day like this. And so, you know, part of it is just as a Nebraska fan, it's like, what would it, you know, again, you can't get to that next question of like, how many Sweet 16s have you got to win the first one. Mm-hmm. So even to be like, okay, well, what's it like to play on Sunday? What's it like to play after you get your first NCAA tournament win? That's still something that Nebraska fans want to be able to see. And, you know, though it didn't happen this year, the good news is it's not out of the realm of possibility to be in this very same position next year, and have an opportunity to be building and moving toward that. This program signed an extension to Fred Hoiberg for a reason. It's not just, you know, pat on the back, job well done. It's the vision of what you see moving forward. Mm-hmm. And this team has a lot of upside. Could be, I mean, sometimes depends. I mean, if they would have made a little run here, I would say definitely didn't quite get that done, but could be a top 25 team entering next season, or at least kind of in that other receiving votes category. Nebraska as a program is on the rise. Just couldn't get it done tonight. Got a little feisty there, a couple technical fouls in the frustration. Right. The right. Players are frustrated. The fans, you could be frustrated as well. I'm sure the coaches are, everybody involves a little bit frustrated, but I'm glad that we start off this post game kind of taking a step back from it and saying, you know what, though? This has been an awesome ride. This has been an awesome run. And let's see if the girls can get it done. You still got a chance to get Texas A&M tonight.
Right. Like, so Texas says that they played weak and scared. Now, did you see Casey? Did you see him on the block? And Bach, you, for basketball, people that play basketball, they knew what he said the moment he said it. Like, you knew exactly. And it wasn't going to matter what language he said it
in. That's
right.
Like,
we knew. For them to fight, to see him smacking the floor, to see him getting in people's faces, to see Juwan getting people, to see Bryce still attack the rim, Josiah attacking every ball, Sam diving into the scorer's table, into the crowd. Listen, no, none of that is a true statement. None of it. None of it. So, I found, and I do want to get to your text, right? Yeah, Tater, yeah, you're right. You know, there are people who are on the various streams, who there's some that wear that weird blue, and then there's some that are just haters. They're just haters. You mad? Okay, be mad, but are you making it better? Are you making it better? We're going to read text, you know, from 9, let's go to, like, what, 9? What time's tip off for the women?
Should be close to 9:30, right?
Right. So we'll go up until 5 minutes before their tip. And we'll read your text. And again, if especially for those that have, you could say tonight sucked. And you can say, man, this feels terrible. But you're not going to say that they didn't try. You're not going to say that they played weak. No, none of that. They played. Look, that's a really good group of young men. And how you talk about really good young men tells me about the person you are, not who they are. That's just from you to me. And here's the other thing. If you're a jerk on any of the streams tonight, if you know me at all, you know, I'll take the privilege away. you can go yell at your cat. Like, yeah. Like, no, don't do that. That's not why we're here. This is Husker Nation trying to find some answers and some calm and some peace. Look, we met here at the Husker Post Game Club. You know, if appropriate, we would raise a glass and say, heck of a ride, boys. Mm. Heck of a run. I think that's the fair way to do it. So we'll get to your text, and we'll go through some of the stat numbers. Bach, what are the numbers? I mean, again, three of the Huskers, we could say that three of the Huskers had quite the night, right? That's mm-hmm. a fair statement.
Yeah. Yeah, I think Josiah Alex certainly, and again, you can pick apart anybody's game throughout that long of a game playing against that good of a team. Yeah, there was a few shots that he layups that maybe he could have made, but the dunk after getting hit in the nose and coming around and getting a rim running mm-hmm. dunk, that was awesome. But overall for him, as his career comes to a close here at Nebraska, 14 points, 11 rebounds, 3 assists. That was awfully impressive. Obviously, Bryce Williams, I mean, he was just kind of steady all night,
right?
7 of 15 from the field, 9 of 10, especially from the free throw line. Nebraska shot well there, and that's been a big improvement this year as opposed to previous Fred Hoiberg teams. So got to give a lot of emphasis of improvement there. 24 points for Bryce Williams. And then, as we mentioned, the other senior, Keisei Tominaga, another senior, I should say. Boogie Coleman, also a senior on this team, who has played his last game as a Husker. But Keisei Tominaga, 21 points on 5 of 11 deep, 7 of 17 overall from the floor. Those were the Huskers in double figures that played really well tonight. Juwan Gary, 9 points, 3 assists, 3 steals, 2 rebounds. Enrique Mass, 7 points. 4 rebounds, 2 assists. And then we've got some contributions off the bench from Jamarcus Lawrence, 6 points and 2 assists, as well as Sam Hoiberg in there. What can happen to Sam Hoiberg sometimes? He doesn't get much in the stat column, but he was out there hustling. And CJ Wilcher, 2 points on 1 of 2 shooting as well. That is for the Huskers. Speaking of the Huskers, hopefully we can hear from Eric Strickland and Jake Sorensen. We'll see as we roll this post game along. Thanks again to 1890 for helping send them out to Memphis. I'm sure right now they're talking to some of the guys or hearing from the coaches. We'll see if we get to them before the end of this post game show. We are up against it, so we better take a break. But you are listening to the Hoops Post Game Show here on 93.7 The Ticket. Thanks to Wall to Wall Wine and Spirits, and as always, Action Plumbing, Heating, AC, and Electrical for making this thing go. We will take a quick break and be right back after these messages.
Action Plumbing, Heating, Air, and Electric brings exciting career opportunities for you or someone you know. They are now hiring plumbers, electricians, and HVAC techs and installers to continually build their professional team. They offer competitive pay and full benefits packages that include health, dental, vision, PTO, and 401k options. Action has created a positive team environment for over 50 years. Apply online at actionlincoln.com.
Wall-to-Wall Wine and Spirits is now open in Lincoln. Shop our expansive collection of wine, beer, spirits, and cigars at 5040 North 27th Street. From top-shelf liquor to crowd-favorite beer, Wall-to-Wall Wine and Spirits has a beverage for every taste and every budget. Plus, join our loyalty program to earn rewards and save on future purchases. Shop Wall-to-Wall Wine and Spirits at 5040 North 27th Street in Lincoln. That's 5040 North 27th Street.
At Union Bank, people don't have your money. Your money has people. First Home people, investment people, people people, people who answer the phone and your chats, dream car people, dream retirement people, driving your dream car in your dream retirement people, small business people, credit card people, and all the other people you need. At Union Bank, our people help you do more than you dreamed possible. So stop in and say hello. We can't wait to see you. Union Bank and Trust, member FDIC.
Mosaic is a nonprofit, whole person healthcare organization that embraces God's call and relentlessly pursues opportunities that empower people with diverse needs to live their best lives. Mosaic in Southeast Nebraska, serving Lincoln and Beatrice, would like to invite you to their monthly Discover the Possibilities Tour events. Events are held on the third Wednesday of every month and are a great way to understand Mosaic's mission. To RSVP, please contact Melindy at 402-429-0088 or visit mosaicinfo.org/southeastnebraska. Sandhills Global is hiring. With their fast-paced, growing culture, they have hundreds of new openings in sales, marketing, traveling support, software development, web design, and more. Full-time roles offer a 4.5-day work week, along with flexible internships in most areas. Career and internship opportunities are available at our global headquarters in Lincoln, Nebraska. Find your fit today at www.sandhills.jobs.
A lot of work goes into making Nebraska, Nebraska. Keeping it green. Helping it thrive. Making it fun. Everything that goes into caring for our outdoors, from waters to wildlife, plays a big role in making Nebraska home. Learn how we help conserve our state's natural resources at outdoornebraska.org.
Paid for by Nebraska Game and Parks. Aired with the Nebraska Broadcasters Association and this station.
Your home is your empire. Protect it with Empire Fence. Get a free instant quote with the online estimating tool at empire-fence.com. See an upfront estimate with no hidden fees. An Empire Fence can provide privacy and improve the appearance of your home. Keep kids and pets in or out of your yard. Increase security and add value to your property. Visit empire-fence.com now to view the stylish and maintenance-free possibilities for your home and get a free instant online quote. Let Empire Fence protect your empire.
Rashawn Jackson here for Bauer Underground, who has been serving local contractors and utility contractors all across the state since 1997. When you see the black and white trucks, you know the baddest dudes in the business have arrived. Bauer is currently looking for equipment operators, laborers, diesel mechanics, and aerial linemen. Join the brotherhood built on hard work, authentic people, and pedigree of success. Bauer, a family-friendly company who reminds you, go be red!
This is Lincoln's home for sports talk on the FM dial. Also online at theticketfm.com.
On the internet.
KNTK FM Firth, 93.7 The Ticket.
Welcome back to the Hoops Postgame Show here on 93.7 The Ticket, NCAA Tournament Edition. Unfortunately, not as great of a party as we'd like it to be, because Nebraska does fall short in their NCAA Tournament matchup in the 8-9 game. Nebraska falls to Texas A&M 98-83. We've been kind of going through our emotions here in studio, and you guys have certainly been doing so on the text line and YouTube and Facebook and Twitter and Twitch. We'd like to thank you for joining us and keeping that chat going. But now it's time to head out to Memphis. We sent some people out there. Jake Sorensen specifically is on the phone with us here from the FedEx Forum, I believe. He might have went back to his hotel there. But in any case, Jake, how is it going? How was the experience live there in Memphis?
Well, to answer the first part, Block, it's not going well. That was pretty bad. You know, it's not good in two straight games. You give up 98 points, but we've been raving all year about the defense of Nebraska. Second half against Illinois, 58 points allowed. First half against A&M, who is not a good shooting team historically, this year at least, 58 points. I mean, we're talking at some point today about potentially the idea of them not getting to 60 in the game. They got 58 in the first half, and I don't know if it was just a bad scout by everybody, the media included, but A&M, who was not shooting threes, had a very good clip all season long, makes everything they look at. You know, Wade Taylor was incredible. They drove it well in the lane. And to me, guys, it was a team without answers all night long. They probably had a good 20-13 lead off the bat. That went away pretty quickly, and that was all she wrote. So very disappointing, but still a good season in general.
Well, I want to start from the beginning too, because this is obviously rarefied air for Nebraska to be in the NCAA tournament, especially for folks our age, Sorensen, where, you know, this is the second time since 1998 that Nebraska's been to the NCAA tournament. How was just Memphis in general? You could tell on the TV screen, we could tell all day long from reports by you and Strick and just all media folks down there that Nebraska was in control of the building. What was kind of the buildup like to this game?
Well, I mean, it could have been better, Box. I mean, if you look at, like you said, if you look at all the different videos that we posted just being here in general, I mean, this is a Nebraska takeover. There's a lot of schools that are here. You know, Houston had people. Even Longwood had some people here to a certain extent. But if you look at all the bars around Beale Street and right around the arena, it looked like the rail yard on a Saturday of Husker football season. So that's the disappointing part, is that, like you said, it's the second time in 26 years they made the tournament. And, you know, came out shooting well. It went poorly defensively, and then offense went cold. But you couldn't have asked for a better crowd for the Huskers. And I got criticized. I put them on Twitter about it. I said the crowd was dead. That was not a shot at Nebraska fans. Nebraska fans were very, you know, they showed up, and when Nebraska was playing well, they were loud. That was more of a just a statement that it's a bummer that the crowd here in Nebraska's favor couldn't be utilized to their advantage because the Huskers were trailing by so much. So kudos to Nebraska fans for traveling here. And, you know, hopefully it doesn't take 10 years to do it again.
Jake, a big part of this finish is the disappointment, because the expectation expectation level had been allowed to raise, to increase, to become higher. But the reality is this, that if we said in September, Nebraska's going to be a 3 seed in the Big Ten tournament, they're going to be an 8 seed in the NCAA tournament, and win 20-plus games, every single Husker fan would have bought in and said, we don't care what the result is tonight. Why is that different now?
Well, I agree with you. You're right. The expectation was, I think, 12th or 13th in terms of the prediction before the year. So they certainly were very much so over what they were supposed to be before the year. But that's the thing, though. As the year goes on, you realize you're not that team that they thought you were before the year. And this seemed like the perfect opportunity for the Huskers to get that first ever tournament win. And that's the thing, guys. I mean, it's a big thing, but it's such a small thing. We're talking about getting a ginormous monkey off your back and just winning one tournament game. And so I'm with you, DP, that, yeah, I mean, on paper, yes, it was a great season. You can't take away anything about the one loss at home at PBA, the great wins against Purdue and Wisconsin, and how they looked against Indiana in the Big Ten tournament. Like, those are great memories from what is going to be remembered as a wonderful season and a surprise season. But right now, in the hurts and the moments of giving up 98 points for a second straight game, and a game you came in feeling pretty good about your chances of winning, you know, it stings. But I think by tomorrow, when we look at it in totality, yeah, we'll say good season, bummer last two games, but we will remember the season for a long time, and hopefully next year they're back in the dance versus waiting for 10 years again.
Yeah, and obviously, you know, the university believes in that. Fred Hoiberg's already signed his extension. As you break this game down, as you kind of look at it, where did it kind of get away from Nebraska?
Well, I think it's pretty clear. I mean, Nebraska was up 20-13. I think they were being pretty aggressive. They're making threes in the early going. But the scouting report on A&M was that we all knew they were a very good rebounding team. Offensive rebounding was excellent, and they showed that. They proved that. What we didn't know was that they could make a bunch of threes. So in the early going, you have Wade Taylor keeping them going, you know, one for one with Casey Tominaga and Rick Mass and Bryce Williams. And that's what kind of gashed Nebraska, was the fact that they had an answer and you didn't expect that answer to happen. So once Nebraska cooled off, ultimately, A&M really never did. They just kept firing away and making shots. And then the worst part was that, hey, you didn't have an answer for them going to the hole. They kept attacking the lane at will and getting buckets or fouls and you get the rebounds if they missed it. So it was disappointing to know that, you know, one part of the scouting report was correct in how they operate. But then the fact they made all these threes and Nebraska went cold, is that's when it changed. And we all know that the guy who ended the first half making 16 straight points, you know, that's something that you can't plan for. And that's just the tournament, though. There's great stories. There's great upsets. There's great drama, and Nebraska, unfortunately, was not on the good end of the drama or the performance tonight.
Through all of this, again, the fact that this team, from some dark places, some dark corners, mm-hmm. got into a situation where they were competing for the Big Ten title, they make the semifinals of the tournament, and then you run into a buzzsaw. And I said all along, I thought it was a terrible matchup with Texas A&M. Yep. I really... In the grand scope, Nebraska would have said yes to some higher seeded teams rather than playing Texas A&M for that very reason. Here's the thing. Texas A&M plays in the SEC. They see a lot of giants and monsters. So K-State Tominaga and Rick Mass aren't going to scare them. They're not they're not going to run them off the line. You're not going to challenge them at the rim. You're just not. And that's a thing, and it's okay because matchups make the game, and this is what we saw. But from your perspective, from the fan base, from the fans that were there in Memphis, what did you see and hear prior to the game? Because I think that's way more, just as important as what the reaction was after the game. What did you see in Memphis? What did you hear?
I mean, it was a fan base that traveled for good reason. They thought they were going to win the game. They thought Nebraska was going to shoot the way they usually do. And again, let's realize, I know Nebraska had a couple games this season where the defense went bad against Maryland and Wisconsin earlier, but until the last two games, the defense had been playing pretty well. I mean, they shut down Indiana in the first game of the Big Ten tournament. They played well before that in these regular season games. And, you know, I just think that no one expected the defense just to collapse like this for two straight games. I mean, 98 points against Illinois and 98 points against A&M is eye-opening. It's eye-opening. Well,
Jake, let me ask you this, because in real talk, that Texas A&M, if you switched the athletes in the uniforms of Texas A&M and Illinois, they're the same team. That was the whole point of this thing, that they look the same, they play the same. The SEC is built different, man. They face Kentucky. Yep. You think they're afraid of Nebraska when you got the five stars they have to face in Kentucky and LSU and South Carolina and Georgia and Alabama? You think from a physical standpoint, that there was any expectation from them, any fear from them. No, this is Nebraska. The last two games of the season, they played the two best teams that they faced all year, even including Purdue. So the results in those cases, I'm not mad. They were still competitive. It just didn't go their way.
No, I'm with you there. You're right. I mean, certainly, ultimately, it was a bad matchup for the Huskers. And you know, I think people forget, and you guys probably brought this up maybe, but in the week, A&M got healthy. It's the team that had some injuries. Wayne Taylor missed some time. You know, the point guard. And then a couple of guys that were banged up. They had a long, they had a skid, and they got hot at the end of the season. But now they're healthy. And honestly, is anybody out there think they can't beat Houston on Saturday or on Sunday? I mean, the way they played, they could beat anybody in the country tonight.
Right.
I don't. If UConn was watching that game and they're playing them tomorrow or Sunday, they'd say, "Oh boy, what did we run into here?" So that's the sucky part, is that you hit a buzzsaw team that is healthy, made more threes than usual, was still attacking like they usually do. But it's just unfortunate for Nebraska that you probably played the best team in round one in terms of the performance of anybody. I mean, I don't know who was going to hang with that team tonight the way they were playing.
Now, we were talking about a little bit of the pregame, the game that went on. Part of the reason we love this sport and these particular days is because of the emotion afterwards, and part of that can be the jubilation from the winning team moving on, their season continues. But for Nebraska, of course, it is an end for some of the careers and an end of the season. What was kind of, as you kind of just viewed Nebraska, obviously this wasn't a buzzer beater where their heart got broken at the end, but as the last couple minutes were winding out into postgame, what was kind of the tone for the Nebraska players and Coach Fred Hoiberg?
Well, you know, as I was jumping on this call, however, we started to talk at the media, and, you know, it just expressed disappointment, and obviously they were surprised at how the game went. You know, they thought they had a good game plan, and you could tell early on that they were doing it. They're up by 7, 20-13, and just, again, they went cold. A&M got very confident, made everything they looked at from 3-point land and driving, and that was all she wrote. So, you know, it's just, in terms of the emotion, I think they were shell-shocked a little bit. And I think they were shell-shocked at the end of the Illinois game. I mean, they were up by 15 points in the second half against Illinois. And at one point in that same half, they were down by 15. That's a 30-point swing in a 20-minute time frame. I mean, that's shell-shocking. And it was the same thing tonight. There are some careless mistakes of thought. The guys just kind of, I don't know if they just lost the mojo. But, you know, basketball is a finicky game. It's up and down. It's there's a lot of highs and lows, and Nebraska unfortunately just could not in the second half get that run going to get back in the game after a 14-point halftime deficit.
I guess a 2-part question here for my final question, at least, is that the whole Trev Alberts saga that was going on took about 30 seconds of screen time of the television. Was there more? I mean, did you see fans? Was there more of that maybe going on at the arena, or was this pretty much focused on basketball?
I think more of it, again, I wasn't watching the TV broadcast. I didn't see a ton of Trev shirts. I mean, obviously at the bars beforehand on the streets, you know, it was a conversation. But there really wasn't a lot of A&M fans in the area. Every time they come around at the bars, they get booed by the Husker fans because they're like, "This is our place. What are you doing in our spot?" So, no, I didn't. You know, I didn't think it was really a storyline at the game, in terms of that. But it's just for Husker fans, just like, man, you know, your AD leaves and then his team beats you. Now the new team beats you, you know, pretty heavily. It's kind of a bummer. And in a year that you had so many positives, so many things that went your direction, and we'll remember a lot of these upsets Nebraska had and great games. It's a bummer that out of nowhere, again, your AD leaves a week ago, and this new team that you played in the tournament takes you down. So, as we always do, guys, we will overcome. We will find a way to be positive and think about the future in a good way. But again, right now, the sting understandably hurts, and it should hurt. It's a rough way to end your season.
Well, my only other question about the crowd shots, too, because I know you didn't see the TV broadcast, was when they went to Nebraska fans, there was plenty to pick from. When they went to Texas A&M fans, I think Johnny Manziel may have got more screen time tonight than maybe Jamarcus Lawrence, who was playing in the game. Did you see Johnny out there?
I didn't see him personally. So there was two separate media sections, as it happens sometimes. There's obviously people that are on the floor And then and the other media section, which we were at, was kind of in the 200 level. So we didn't have the greatest, you know, view of like that kind of area where Johnny was at. But obviously I saw social media posts of him being there. Didn't get a chance to see him in person, up close and personal. But, no, Johnny is a big name. And Johnny's an, you know, iconic figure from A&M. So, you know, they're going to do what they want to do to get the guys in the broadcast. So Johnny was the guy. And you know what? Johnny's a happy guy right now. His team put up 98 points. They're on to play Houston, who, by the way, is up 14-7 right now in Longwood.
Yeah, that bar tab that is going to be run tonight is going to be something special. So we're told Strick just texted said he's going to jump on the stream. So we appreciate you, bro. Job well done on all of this. And we will see you Monday back in Lincoln.
Yep. All right, guys. Have a good one.
Yes, sir. Yeah, Bach, it's always the season. Again, that's another like added plus to March Madness is you don't know when your season's going to end.
Yeah.
Like Nebraska's been bad. So you knew, probably first night of Big Ten.
Yeah, Wednesday.
Like Big Ten. Like, wait a minute. This 22nd of March thing. You know, you have to recalibrate.
It really, along with like the late spring football, like it's weird because you kind of get this kind of like, oh, spring football's next week. Like that's a quick turnaround.
Yeah. Like, wait a minute. This is a thing. Oh, they're still playing. Like it was having to adjust, like even the programming schedule to go, oh, we have to jump off because the Huskers are playing. Like we haven't had to say, hey, we have to back out of a tournament game because the Huskers are going to be playing. Like, no, well done.
Yeah.
Well done.
And another job well done, I'm sure, from Eric Strickland out there. And first of all, job well done on making the late travel arrangements there to get to Memphis. But Strick, as you join us here, obviously you want to get your initial thoughts on Nebraska not necessarily being as competitive as you wanted. Ended up losing this game 98-83 at Texas A&M. What are your initial thoughts on the game?
Well, the initial thoughts was, look, they got off to a great start. You know, K-State was on fire. It looked initially like the K-State and Wade show. Wade the fourth, those guys were literally just putting on a clinic. It was a shooting clinic, and, you know, they looked like they were going to have a good night. Then you have a couple of situations, you had a couple missed layups by Josiah Alec, and then all of a sudden the game starts to get away. And one of the things that you just saw is had an opportunity to speak with Buzz as well closely, and the team has learned a lot of lessons themselves. He stated that they went through a little bit of adversity, that the team gelled and became a little bit more united, and one of the things that they felt that they needed to do was attack, get downhill, and go after the glass. And everything that we said, Bach and DP, everything that we talked about that they needed, that they couldn't do, happened pretty much. They got comfortable. Guys that hadn't been playing well, Obakazi, it was averaging like he was averaging like 6.3 points a game for the season, and he ends up going nuts. And when guys get comfortable, you allow them to get comfortable. They drew off of the energy of Wade the fourth. And even some of their best rebounders got in foul trouble, but the other guys picked up the slack. But we didn't get that. We didn't get that on the other side. We had, we had some miscues. They did a great job on Rick Mass. That was one of the things that when I asked the question, which we'll probably share on Monday, I'll bring some of those sound bites back. But they said one of the things they wanted to do is take Rick Mass out of the game, and they did so with great double teams, hard double teams, something that probably Rick Mass, I would venture to say, they probably didn't expect was going to be thrown at him, and didn't really make the adjustment in that manner. And until the second half, it was a little too late. And then you can't trade buckets with them. You can't continue to give up offensive rebounds. And they were already at a deficit in the first half, and it just continued. And unfortunately, wasn't able to get back into the game.
Strick, what can you do? You've been on the floor in various situations at various levels when somebody gets on a heater. What do you do when several people get on a heater? Like, there's nothing. I mean, you can change schemes, you can change matchups, but some nights it's just their night, right?
Yeah, yeah. And that's what I said. I actually sent an X out. Sometimes you're going to have nights like that. When you do have nights like that, one of the things that you have to do is you might have to do something that they tried to do, but it was a little too late. Like, where their energy was picked up, they had that dog in them look. Like, they were hungry. Like, they wanted to eat their, you know, like, there was the last bone out there. And if we was, if it was either you or me getting that bone, it's going to be me. That's kind of the look that they had on their, in their eyes. And you saw it by the energy. I mean, I'm going to be honest. That was the first time I ever seen Bryce get a little bit of energetic after a couple of and one situations. But that's what they had in them. They seemed to have a little bit of fire in them. And obviously it was sparked by Wade the fourth. So DP, they had a good game plan. I said this, I think, on one of the earlier shows. I said, I would not play this team the same way that I would normally play, with that, you know, guide them to the baseline type of deal. Just too quick, too athletic. I would square them up. They're not very good shooters, but they were on their heels. Like, you can square somebody up, but you still got to be kind of in an aggressive manner and aggressive stance. But it was like they were on their heels pretty much all night. And these guys were literally getting downhill. And one thing that was pretty frustrating, DP, is, you know, I'm a cerebral guy and I like to watch tendencies. All of the left-handed guys were doing the same thing to them all night. Hard drive to the right, spin back to the left to finish. And then we were guarding them to not drive right. And I'm like, no, you want them to, you know, kind of drive right, but don't let them spin back to the left. I mean, they were all trying to get back to that left hand somehow, some way. And we just couldn't keep them in front. It was like the Terrence Shannon show, but it was with multiple people all night. That was basically what it was. It was basically the same score, and it happened on back-to-back nights. That's one of the things that they're going to have to address, DP and Bach. They're going to have to figure out how these 6'5", 6'6", guys, long wingspans, get downhill on you. You got to figure out a way to defend those type of guys.
We were talking about this, Bach and I were talking about it earlier, and I mentioned Jake, but it seems to me like these two teams, Texas A&M and Illinois, like, you could swap jerseys and style of play. And the only thing is that, if anything, maybe Texas A&M had more dog in them. But that whole thing of how you attack, how they respond to it, the athletic ability and space, and then how strong they were. Look, we didn't give Texas A&M credit for being strong. Those guys are strong. Yeah. So there's some nights, and I would imagine that if you know Nebraska talent, as Hoiberg does, he knows that, okay, that's just not a thing we match up well with. Like, we can do this for 30 games, win 24 of them, 22 of them, but we're going to run into some nights where they're just better than us and we're going to have to play over our heads. How do you adjust to that in an off season without wrecking the progress you made playing the way that you play? How do you take the next step forward? And then maybe the part B is, you know, what is the next step for this Huskers program?
Well, listen, shout out to Buzz Williams. I've known him a long time, but his staff, they were prepared, because it didn't matter what Fred threw at them. It didn't matter if it was man, if it was zone. They had something for it. Like, there was something that they were going to run, that it didn't matter what they threw at them. It was like they were very well prepared. And that's not to say that Fred Hoiberg and the staff didn't prepare Nebraska, or they weren't prepared. It's just that it was unfortunate that this team was on a heater. They were very well prepared, and they just played out of their minds on a night where this is what my worst nightmare was when I woke up in the morning, was you just hope that this team that doesn't shoot the ball well, doesn't play well, and what would be crazy, they'll come into a Sunday and they might can't hit a freaking barn. You know, it's just one of those things, right? Sometimes the adrenaline, sometimes the emotion, it can affect some people one way and it can affect some the other. But once that all wears out, sometimes you revert back to who you were. You know what I'm saying? Like, you can really start feeling yourself one minute.
Yeah, they're out there, Strick. I mean, think about it. Houston's out there lining it up against Longwood. And because you play the way you play, like you're going to copy success and you're going to do what you think you do well. But sometimes that can walk you into different situations because the MSC folks don't play Big Ten basketball. They don't play straight line basketball. They play an athletic, creative, a little bit stronger in it. As a matter of fact, it's a problem because JMU is giving Wisconsin some work. And it's just we saw what JMU did against Michigan State. So sometimes matchups play over talent. That some nights in this March, hey, have a bad night, you're going home. That's what March Madness is. That's why they call it the Madness.
That's a fact. Absolutely.
And we are getting up against it because the women's basketball game is going to tip off here pretty soon. So we will make way so you guys can go out there and check that game out. Hopefully Nebraska can get one against Texas A&M. Strick, I'm glad you're here, though, because I want to say thank you again. We've done this for a few seasons now. This was by far our best season of the Hoops Postgame Show. So thanks for another year. It's been an incredible ride.
Yeah,
man, absolutely. It's been always fun to get with you and to be able to share. Thanks to all the listeners. I will say this, the building was full. I mean, look, it would have been mayhem had Nebraska won that game because I'm talking about you saw like a little sprinkle. If it was a cake, it was just a little sprinkle of Texas A&M fans, and it was a full bowl of Nebraska fans. And, you know, I hate that for them. One of the things was when we walked around, when we were in the hotel or just strolling down the street, there was a lot of ticket fans and a lot of ticket listeners, man. So we appreciate you as listeners as well. Those who shouted us out, those that said hello, those are here right now. And those who were at Buffalo Wings and Rings, man, we appreciate you guys. We love you dearly. And it's been great.
Great run, man.
And there you hear from Eric Strickland. We also had Jake Sorensen. Thanks again to 1890 Initiative for helping send those guys out there as well. As Austin Overman out to Corvallis. So stay tuned to his Twitter as this game proceeds tonight. And hopefully, like I said, again, Nebraska women's basketball can get it done. But that'll wrap it up for our Hoops postgame show for not just tonight, but for the year. And I want to do one more final thank you to our sponsors, Action Plumbing, Heating, AC, and Electrical for yet another year, as well as Wall-to-Wall Wine and Spirits. For DP, myself, Jake Balkovin, Jake Sorensen, who joined us, as well as Stricky out there, Eric Strickland out there in Memphis. We will bid you adieu, and we will see you around the corner. Always plenty of great sports topics going on here at 93.7 The Ticket, so stay tuned, and go Huskers. Still got another chance at the Aggies tonight, but that'll wrap it up for us. We will see a great season, everybody involved. Go Big Red.
Action Plumbing, Heating, Air, and Electric brings exciting career opportunities for you or someone you know. They are now hiring plumbers, electricians, and HVAC techs and installers to continually build their professional team. They offer competitive pay and full benefits packages that include health, dental, vision, PTO, and 401k options. Action has created a positive team environment for over 50 years. Apply online at actionlincoln.com.
Wall-to-Wall Wine and Spirits is now open in Lincoln. Shop our expansive collection of wine, beer, spirits, and